Hello and welcome back. Well, in this class, as I told you in the last class, that I'll be telling you the difference between conductors, semiconductors and insulator through a band model. Well, first I'll tell you how a band model works. The distance from the center, as you can see, nucleus over here and electron, this distance from the center of the nucleus to the valence electron is known as valence band. This is a valence band. Now suppose this is the minimum distance required for an electron to do conduction. If an electron is at this distance or beyond this distance, the force of attraction from the nucleus on this electron is so weak that if you apply an EMF, the electron can easily move. Well, the more the distance between the nucleus and the electron, the weaker will be the force of attraction from the nucleus on the electron, and so the more will be the probability of electron to become a free electron. So the minimum distance from the nucleus to the electron where the force of attraction becomes so less that if you apply small EMF, the electron will start conducting electricity, that is known as the conduction band. And the distance from the nucleus to the valence electron is known as the valence band. So we have two different band, that is conduction band and valence band. The distance from the nucleus till where the electrons they are present is the valence band, and the distance from the nucleus, minimum distance from the nucleus at or beyond which if the electron is present, the force of attraction from the nucleus is so less that it will start conducting electricity, is the conduction band. Now we'll see what happens in case of metals, or we can say conductors, semiconductors and insulators. Well, if I talk about conductors, when I'm saying, I'm basically talking about metals. Metals, as you know, they have large atomic radii. So larger the atomic radii, more the distance from the nucleus to the electron, more will be the energy. So instead of distance, on this axis, I'm writing energy. Well, energy and distance, they are directly proportional. More the distance from the nucleus, higher will be the energy. Now suppose you just consider that somewhere here you have got a nucleus. Metals, they have a larger atomic radii. Now suppose the valence shell is till this distance. So here this distance, we can say, is a valence band. So this is a valence band. Now in case of metals, since their atomic radii is very large, this is their valence band. And suppose the conduction band starts from this place. Beyond this, you have got a conduction band. So this is the conduction band you have got. In this case, you will notice one thing, that some of the electrons of valence band, these electrons, they are in the valence band and they are also in the conduction band. That means these electrons, they are so away from the nucleus. The atoms of metals are so large, their electrons are so away from the nucleus that some of the electrons, they are lying in the valence band, in the conduction band. That means what? The force of attraction from the nucleus on the outermost electron is so very weak that even if you apply EMF, they'll start conducting electricity. So this is how metals they are, according to valence band theory. They have got a very large atomic radii, their valence band is very big. So some of the electron of valence band, they lie in the conduction band. So whenever an EMF is applied, they start conducting electricity. This is how a metal is. Now we'll see semiconductors, or we'll see insulators. Generally non-metals, they are insulators. So non-metals, they are insulators and they have got a smaller atomic radii. Non-metals, as you know, have smaller atomic radii. So if I'm drawing distance from the nucleus, or I can say energy, since they are smaller, suppose their valence shell is till here. So this is the valence shell I have got. I can write it as valence band. This is the valence band I have got. And somewhere here, I have got their conduction band. That is at the same distance. Here is the conduction band. So this is conduction band. Here in metals also, this was conduction band. Conduction band. Now since non-metals, they are very small, there's a big gap between the conduction band and the valence band. A very big energy gap. Again, I'll recapitulate, then it will become easier for you to understand. See, the distance from the nucleus till where the electrons they are present is known as the valence band, and that minimum distance that is required for an electron to be in order to conduct electricity is known as the conduction band. Metals, they have larger atomic radii. So some of their valence electrons, outermost valence electrons, they overlap with the conduction band. They are so away from the nucleus that the force of attraction from the nucleus is very weak. Even if you apply small EMF, they will start conducting electricity. So in metal, some of their valence electrons, they are in the conduction band and it can easily conduct electricity. Whereas if I talk about non-metals, they've got a smaller radii. That means their valence electrons, they are closer to the nucleus. So they are tightly held towards the nucleus. Whereas the valence band is away from the nucleus, that means there is a big energy gap between the valence band and the conduction band. So if you want non-metals to conduct electricity, you have to provide large amount of energy so that their electron can jump from their valence band to conduction band, which is generally not possible. That's why most of the non-metals, they behave like insulators. So this is what happens in insulators. There's a big energy gap. This energy gap is known as forbidden band. So this is what a forbidden band is. Big energy gap between valence band and conduction band. Next we'll see semiconductors. Now if I talk about semiconductors, we can say they are somewhat between metals and non-metals or metalloids. They are smaller than metals, but they are larger than non-metals. So in this case, here I have got energy. This is the valence band. Valence band. And somewhere here you have got a conduction band. So this is a conduction band. And between them you have forbidden band. So here you have forbidden band. And as you can see, the forbidden band is very small. So some of the electrons can easily gain energy and can jump from valence band to conduction band and they can conduct electricity. That's why semiconductors, they exhibit limited electrical conduction. So in semiconductors, there's a small energy gap. The forbidden band is very small as compared to insulator. So some of the electron or valence band, they can easily get energy and they can jump from their valence band to conduction band and they can conduct electricity. So this is a band model of conductors, semiconductors and insulators. Next we'll talk about magnetic character. This is perhaps the last topic. Magnetic character of crystals. Magnetic character of crystals. My dear students, I just want to remind you one thing that here the lectures which you are getting are purely based on the topics which are there in your textbook. As far as solid state is concerned, plenty of other topics they are also there. I'm not taking those topics over here. Some separate lectures you will be getting for your competitive studies. I will be taking those lectures over there. The only topics which are there in your textbook will be taken in this lecture. So magnetic character of crystals. As you know, every substance has got some domains, some dipoles in it. Based on that, we have a magnetic character of the substance. So if we talk about, first we'll talk about paramagnetic. If I talk about paramagnetic substances, oxygen is a paramagnetic substance. Well, when we talk about paramagnetic substance, they generally have unpaired electrons, and so they have domains. All the domains, see the domains, they are randomly arranged. They are randomly arranged. But in the presence of a magnetic field, if you are putting them in a magnetic field, all domains, they get aligned. So on one of the side you will have north pole, on another side you will have south pole of all the domains. That's why paramagnetic substances, they are weakly attracted by the applied magnetic field. Do remember this thing, because I'm not writing it down. Paramagnetic substances, they are weakly attracted by the applied magnetic field. Example is O2, you can say Fe3 positive, they are paramagnetic substances, or Cr3 positive. Next, if I talk about diamagnetic, as the name suggests, diamagnetic, in them the domains, they are grouped together. So if one of the domain has got magnetic line of forces like this, the another one will have in the opposite direction. Again, one has got like this, the another one will have like this. That means the magnetic line of forces of one of the domain will get cancelled out by the magnetic line of forces of another domain. So there is no net magnetic line of forces of these substances, and that's why when they are placed in an applied magnetic field, the magnetic field tries to induce a magnetic moment in these substances, and in turn it repulses these substances. Again, in diamagnetic substances we have paired domains, and these paired domains, they are in opposite direction. So the magnetic line of forces of one of the domain are cancelled out by another. As a result of that, they are repelled by the applied magnetic field, because magnetic field tries to induce a magnetic moment in these substances. If I talk about diamagnetic, NaCl is a good example of a diamagnetic substance. So NaCl, H2O, they are diamagnetic substances. Likewise, I talk about ferromagnetic. Third is ferromagnetic. This again have unpaired domains which align in a magnetic field. All domains, they are in the same direction like paramagnetic. But unlike paramagnetic, ferromagnetic substances, they are attracted strongly by the applied magnetic field. So they will be attracted strongly. And ferromagnetism is a permanent effect. Even if you remove magnetic field, the substance will keep on exhibiting its magnetic character for some time. After this, fourth we have antiferromagnetic. If we talk about antiferromagnetic, in antiferromagnetic also, you have unpaired domains, but they spin in opposite direction. They are not paired, they are unpaired, but they are spinning in opposite direction. So like diamagnetic, the magnetic line of forces of one of the domain is cancelled out by that of another. So like diamagnetic, they are also repelled by the applied magnetic field. But unlike diamagnetic, they are not paired, they are unpaired. So equal number of domains, they are spinning in opposite direction. So they are repelled by the applied magnetic field. Next we have ferrimagnetic. Fifth is ferrimagnetic. If we talk about ferrimagnetic, they have unpaired domains. Most of the domains, they are spinning in the same direction, but some of the domains can spin in opposite direction. So the domains which are spinning in opposite direction will cancel out magnetic line of forces of some of the domains, but still some of the magnetic line of forces will be there, which will overlap with the magnetic line of forces of the applied magnetic field. Hence, ferrimagnetic, they have unpaired domains and they are weakly attracted towards the magnetic field. So once again, a recapitulation. Paramagnetic, they are weakly attracted, they have unpaired domains, so their magnetic line of forces coincide with the applied magnetic line of forces. Hence, they are weakly attracted. Diamagnetic, they have paired domains, so the magnetic line of forces of one domain is cancelled out by that of another. That's why when they are placed in an applied magnetic field, the magnetic field has a tendency of inducing magnetic moment into them and in turn repulses them. Next is ferromagnetic. Ferromagnetic again have unpaired domains. so that their magnetic line of forces overlap with the magnetic line of forces of applied magnetic field. But unlike paramagnetic, they are more strongly attracted by the applied magnetic field. Next, we have antiferromagnetic, in which most of the domains, they are spinning in one direction. However, some of them, they are spinning in opposite direction. So they are weakly attracted by the applied magnetic field. So this is all about the magnetic character of crystals. And this is all about the last topic of your textbook. Definitely, you will be getting some more videos on solid state, in which I'll be teaching you something about the radius ratio rule, the different type of crystals like sodium chloride, cesium chloride, zinc blend, fluoride, antifluoride, and Bragg's equation and Miller indices. So that I'll be doing later on. First, I was supposed to finish up with the topic of your textbook. That's what I'm doing. And again, one request to you, please do subscribe my channel. Please do press the bell icon so that you'll get all the notifications on time. Thank you very much. Thanks for watching.